In today's video, I'm going to pare things right back to basics to make two watercolour Christmas cards that are so easy even a beginner could have a go. Also, I'll be talking about how I go from sketch and inspiration to finished card with all my best watercolour tips along the way. Hi, I'm Debbie Hughes, and if you're new here, I'm a full-time card designer with 10 plus years of card making experience. I have a blog and website, Lime Doodle Design, and here on YouTube I share videos with how-to tutorials of the techniques and products I use. You'll always find links to these products in the YouTube description below. So let's start from the beginning. Although I keep a digital calendar, I still find it helpful to write things down. And so I have a Hobonichi folio in which I keep a diary at the back. This is a mossery for those that have a planner interest. And here I keep a note of appointments and such. Then at the front of the folio, I keep a Leuchtturm dot grid notebook where I run a simple bullet journal system on a day-by-day basis. Here I can expand on my day, appointments, and looking here for the ladies listening, don't forget to get your breast screening done. Having a page-by-page bullet journal system running like this means it's easy to note down anything from meal plans to card designs that pop into my head. Back in early September, I had the idea of a long slimline card with a simple watercolour background and the slimline Christmas die over the top. I marked this page with a piece of washi for future reference. And then a few things converged this month to inspire me to make this video. Seeing Christina Werner's Simply Watercolour Christmas class at online card classes brought me back to my roots of clean and simple cards. Secondly, I saw a lovely piece by Creation CC. I think Catherine Coate, on her channels, which reminded me of my sketch back in September. I'll link both of these below and I highly recommend you check them out. And on the slimline card design idea, I want to share with you the envelopes and from there the card and panel sizes that I use to make a slimline card. I use the slimline envelopes from Simpsons Stamp and there are a rainbow of colour options available. Taking one of the envelopes, which is 9.5 by 4.8, I make cards 9 by 3.5 inches and cut panels to go on top, which are 8.5 by 3 inches. Check out the video I'll link below by Jennifer Maguire, who goes into more detail on slimline card sizes and options. Firstly, starting with a panel inspired by CC, I penciled a narrow border to contain the watercolour area and simple wavy lines across the card. I then taped the piece to a board with 3M painter's tape. I positioned the tape so it was just on or over the pencil border, so I can erase the lines once I'm done painting. As for the wavy pencil lines across the panel, these will get trapped by the watercolour and I won't be able to erase them afterwards. So I used an eraser or kneaded eraser to lighten the lines slightly so I can still see them, but once some watercolour is on top, they won't be noticeable. The next part of this tutorial is the key part for me, colour. And yet it's one of the stages that I think a lot of people miss out. Pre-planning a colour scheme means that once you get to the actual painting part, where you often have less time to react to the water, then you have a greater chance of success. Today I'm using Daniel Smith paints, in particular Pyrrole Crimson, Perylene Green and Buff Titanium. With a couple of drops of water mixed in, these will be the full strength colours. And then I diluted the green and red and also mixed a touch of red into the Buff Titanium to warm it up a bit. With this Christmassy colour scheme planned out, I start painting the areas defined by the wavy lines with the full strength red to start with. As I dip my brush into a jar of water to help spread the colour out over the block to be painted, it dilutes the colour and by dipping my brush back into the concentrated paint mix, I drop more paint into the wet area. The paint quickly spreads in the water in this wet and wet technique, which is one of my favourites of the watercolour techniques. I picked out three areas to paint red that were spaced evenly through the panel. I used a synthetic size 4 round brush and carefully followed the pencil guidelines. As I continue to paint, let's talk about the card I'm using. This is a piece of Archer's Cold Press card. Cold press means it has some texture to it, which helps to give lovely watercolour effects, but the texture does make it slightly more tricky to get smooth lines as you paint. The brush catches on the texture and the lines can have slightly rough edges. To combat this, make sure your brush is fully loaded with paint, as then it won't catch on the texture and you'll get a much smoother line. After adding the three stripes of concentrated red, I moved on to three stripes of green, again, making sure they were evenly spaced throughout the panel. Oh, and one important point to note is that up until this point, none of the areas I've painted have been adjacent to each other. This allows the paint to dry before painting the next stripe, either side of it. This is important because if you painted the next stripe before the adjacent one was dry, the colours would mix together, that same wet and wet movement of the paint through water. You'll see this later on and how I fixed this mistake. So it's important to make sure each stripe is dry before moving on to the next one. Here you see me touch the paper, and that is one way to determine if an area is dry or not. If the paper still has moisture in it, the paper will feel cool to the touch. You can see now what happens if you miss that step and start painting a stripe when its neighbour is not yet dry. The wet paint moves and blends into the adjacent area. I fix this by cleaning my brush and wiping it on a cloth so it's just damp. This is known as a thirsty brush, and you can lift the paint with the brush, wiping it off on a cloth as you go. I then spread the remaining colour out evenly before thoroughly drying the area, after which I came back in with red again and sharpened up the join between the two areas, and you'd never know I made a mistake. The creamy beige colour I'm using today is called Buff Titanium and is semi-opaque, whereas the other two colours are transparent. I tend to like transparent watercolours, and so I'm never quite sure about Buff Titanium. On its own, I'd never pick it out as a colour to love, but in a colour palette, it acts as a soothing break, a neutral ground on which the other colours can play off. This is true also of using different strengths of the three colours. If I'd painted all the stripes in the most concentrated mix each time, then you wouldn't have that play of light and depth between the stripes, which makes it interesting. Having finished all the stripes, I carefully remove the painter's tape, making sure to keep at an angle to help the tape lift without tearing the paper, and then used an eraser to remove the pencil border. And that's the first panel finished. Moving on to the second panel, I've cut the card and drawn a pencil border before I take the card down to the board as before. This is the version of this card I originally envisaged in my notebook, with stripes blending into one another. To achieve this, I use the wet and wet technique I mentioned earlier. When the stripes blended together last time, that wasn't a look I wanted on that panel. However, for this card, it's all about those blends. And to do this, you have to work quickly while the paint is still wet. With this in mind, having a palette of colours mixed and ready to go is important. If you try and mix colours as you go along, there's a risk that the paper will have dried and you won't get the soft blends of colour you are after. I'll show you later on what that looks like. So I mixed up a variety of combinations of my three colours, full concentration red and green, diluted versions of those, and then mixes with the cream. To help the colours blend and move together, I angled my board by placing an acrylic block underneath the top of the board. This creates a gradient which will encourage the paint to move down the panel. I'm going to keep this first part of the painting at real speed so you can firstly see how slowly I paint, but also get an idea of how much time you have to work with to keep that lower edge of the paint wet and blending into the next stripe. I wanted to use the same size 4 round brush as I did in my last panel to keep the supplies for these cards to the minimum. However, if you have a bigger brush, it would hold more paint and therefore make it easier to keep things wet and moving. I dipped my brush into the full concentration red first and then pulled the colour down with some dilute red. Next, I dipped into one of the cream mixers, and as you can see, all the layers are mixing and blending together. I randomly dipped into the colours in my palette without too much thought. I think if you try and plan these things, it's more likely to look less natural. While the paint is still wet, I went back in with drips of concentrated colour to add depth and interest. However, keep an eye on that green spot on the top right. The paper had already started to dry there, and as such, there wasn't anywhere for the paint to move on the top edge. And instead of a nice gentle blend, I got a hard edge. Not ideal, but once the panel was dry and I'd added sentiment on top, you don't notice it. I slowed things down again here so that you can see the effect of adding drips of clean, clear water into wet areas. The water pushes the colour outwards and you get an interesting highlight area. Again, to do this, the area that you're dropping the water into needs to be wet still so that the paint can move. I let this panel dry naturally to get the smoothest and most interesting blends. Then I lifted the painter's tape and erased the pencil guidelines again. And here's the two panels next to each other. On the first panel, I like how the watercolour fills the whole area, and there are some interesting watercolour characteristics within each stripe. With the second panel, I love to see those blends from one colour to the next. You can see that hard edge on the green spot though, but that will get covered up in the main with the sentiment. From my original sketch, I planned on using the Slimline Christmas die set, which, as the name suggests, is perfect for slimline cards. The die comes in two parts, an open outline style lettering, and then a background piece on which to mount the first die if you wish. I die cut the Christmas word die from Gold Mirror card, and when I removed the pieces from the die, I made sure to keep the inside pieces for the letters R and A. The background element of the die helps the delicate lettering of the Christmas words stand out over busy backgrounds. However, I didn't want to cover up too much of the lovely watercolour, so I die cut the background from vellum. The translucency of vellum means you'll still be able to see the watercolour a little through the vellum. I added Gina K Connect glue to the back of the Christmas word element and dabbed it on scratch paper before adhering it to the vellum, and this helps to take excess glue off the die to stop it squidging out when placed on the vellum. I repeated the process so that I had two identical sentiment pieces to add to the cards, and then added tiny pieces of foam adhesive to the back of each before adhering to the card fronts. I then generously added foam tape to the back of both panels. Watercolouring, even when taped to a board, does make the panels warp a little, and the foam tape helps to keep them lovely and flat when adhered to the card bases, which I'd cut from Nina Desert Storm card in the 100-pound weight for a sturdy card base. So that completes these two easy watercolour Christmas cards based on a sketch I had in my notebook and with inspiration from Christina Werner's online card class and also from Creation CC over on Instagram. I want to thank you for hanging in to the end here, and I'd love to know if you have any ideas for future videos you'd like to see. Let me know in the comments below, and I really appreciate the feedback. I'll leave links in the YouTube description to the products that I've used today, as well as a coordinating link to the blog post over at limedudadesign.com. I want to thank you for joining me today, and if you've enjoyed this tutorial, I'd be delighted if you'd give it a thumbs up and to subscribe to this channel. Also, if you'd like to get notified when a new video is out, don't forget to hit the bell button next to the subscribe button too. Thanks, and I'll see you next time.